What seemed to the naked eye to be an ordinary rabbit hole instead turned out to Alice to be the humble entrance to an entire kingdom. For don't just look at the rabbit hole, follow it down and let the RSI blow your mind. This might be the most important and valuable trading episode on the entire YouTube. What would your reaction be if I were to tell you there is a way to often enough determine tops and bottoms with uncanny precision? Would you perhaps say that it sounds too good to be true? Probably, and I guess I would myself too. I'm not saying that what I'm about to present to you is a holy grail, for such things don't exist. But what I am about to present to you certainly will broaden your horizons and introduce you to a trading wonderland you did not know existed. One that will impressively often give you crystal clear clues of when a distribution phase is about to end and when an accumulation phase is about to shift to a markup. Or simply put, when to buy near the bottom and when to sell near the top. Now, in the previous episode of this trilogy, we discussed how the traditional RSI usage is dissatisfactory and rather two-dimensional at best. In this episode, however, we will discuss at length how to properly use the RSI and how to extract full value from this remarkable indicator, for it sure contains more than first meets the eye. Before we get to the meat, the strategies I'm about to outline are to a good extent based on the profound and extensive findings of Constance M. Brown, presented in the book Technical Analysis for the Trading Professional. This book on its own is quite a strenuous read, and I presume its difficulty is also the reason why its techniques have not reached a wider audience. For this book certainly is a sweaty endeavor. It's the type of book that can drain you on energy and where each page takes forever to read because of all the necessary processing that it comes with in order to fully grasp the mind-blowing and intellectual trading concepts that are being conveyed. My gift to you, dear viewer, is therefore to repackage that RSI wisdom into a more easily digestible one. I've chewed through the rock so that you can now smoothly drink it. Okay, that was fucking awkward, but you get the point. All in all, it's for your benefit and enjoyment. But please bear in mind that despite the concept is half digested into a smoothie-looking gooey, it is still quite complex, and if you don't grasp it all on the first try, don't worry, neither did I. I probably lost 3 kilos from learning all this. What I do recommend, however, is to watch this episode, digest it, and sleep on it, and then watch it again and again until it makes perfect sense, for it eventually will. For rest assured, the treat in this bag is a nice one. For unlike any traditional RSI usage, which is limited at best and often contradictory and full of noise, knowing how to properly use the RSI rather often paints a crystal clear picture of the market strength and situation and what actually awaits. One that doesn't force you to guess, but rather tells it as it is. Of course, as with regards to anything else within technical analysis, a proper RSI usage is not a science that never fails you, but it sure gives you some very valuable information what you're currently looking at and of what lays ahead, especially when it comes to market phase shifts. We're talking from a distribution phase to a markdown or from an accumulation phase to a markup. Having access to this information and nothing else would on its own grant you a humongous advantage as it would help you to sell near a top and buy near a bottom. At least near the top of a markup and near the bottom of a markdown. And the best part is that whenever you are wrong, you get away cheaply. This means that the RSI can help you spot some true. So, as you may have noticed if you've followed this channel for some time, and especially the technical episodes, I often talk about the bearish blue and bullish red RSI lines and bearish blue and bullish red channels. I'm sure some of you have already figured out roughly what these entail, yet I will of course go through them all in detail and explain how to fully exploit them for maximum value. These lines and channels are namely the very foundation upon which everything in this episode is based upon, and in order to measure and interpret its information properly and for the techniques to work at all, the RSI needs to be meticulously set up. This is the critical part. We will therefore begin by setting up the RSI properly, after which we will dig into the very strategies and techniques behind it. Now, once I've set up my standard indicators such as EMAs, Ichimokus, and trading volumes on a new technical graph, I immediately move on to the RSI graph. This is the default look on investing.com's graphs, with some weird purple middle section background and a visible scale ranging from 20 to 80. The first thing I do is to extend the scale for it to display the full 0 to 100 range. I then move on to the setting where I change the background to neutral, change the dotted line to a full one, change the color of the two preset lines to blue, change the upper level to 60, and finally change the plot color to dark gray. These are my default settings. This brings us to the placement of the RSI lines. There are 5 in total, 2 blue ones, 2 red ones, and 1 green. The placement of these are based on historical pivotal price levels and will therefore vary depending on the underlying equity and time frame used. Don't worry, we will discuss this at length in a bit. The only exception though, the only static line, is the green RSI line, which should always be set at 50. No exceptions. Once you have properly and correctly set the red and blue RSI lines, they stay there. And if you have to alter them, it is more often than not due to not having set them properly in the first place. For setting them properly is actually the difficult and critical part in all of this. And you may find yourself constantly changing them back and forth in the beginning before you get the hang of it. There are exceptions when it is correct to alter properly set red and blue lines as the equity slightly changes its behavior over time. This, however, is very rare and we will leave it at that for now. All you need to focus on is to do the groundwork properly. Now, RSI line placements will vary depending on the time frame used, even if you're looking at the same equity. This can be compared to moving averages and how one specific moving average will have completely different values on the 1 hour chart as opposed to on the daily chart. It's as simple as that. So what might require certain RSI line settings on the daily might and most likely will require different RSI line settings on the hourly, on the 15 minute, on the weekly, monthly, and so on. This of course complicates things practically as you might need to set up different charts with different time frames for equities that you trade often. Personally, I have 3 charts for the Swedish OMX S30, one for the hourly, one for the daily, and one for the weekly. Once you get accustomed enough to quickly finding the proper RSI levels, you can fairly easily spot them and adjust the lines as you go. Until then, I am, however, aware that this is a bit of a hassle, but it's definitely worth it. A small price of inconvenience in return for a big technical reward. Now, when setting up the RSI lines, we look for continual pivotal price levels and RSI levels that match. What this means is that in order to accurately place the red and blue RSI lines, we look for local price highs and lows, as in reversals, and the RSI levels that are the most frequently occurring. We particularly look for those pivot levels in previous accumulation and distribution phases. This is because the prime strength of these RSI techniques is to distinguish at an early stage when a shift from an accumulation to a markup phase or from a distribution to a markdown phase is about to happen. But this is not enough, for once we do identify where pivotal price and RSI levels frequently match, there are still some key rules which we must adhere to when setting the RSI lines. For the various RSI levels cannot be placed anywhere. No, each line needs to be within certain predetermined ranges regardless of the time frame. In terms of the bullish and bearish lines, there are 2 respectively, one lower bullish red and one upper bullish red, as well as one lower bearish blue and one upper bearish blue. The lower bearish blue is the most static one of the red and blue lines and should almost exclusively be set at 30, at least on the daily, weekly, and monthly. I rarely, if ever, set it at anything but 30 sharp, and only in certain discretionary situations have I found the placement to range between 28 to 32. If you go above or below this level at all, something is likely very wrong. The upper bearish blue line, the one we set at a default 60 level in the RSI settings before, should rarely go below 57 and never above 63. Usually its normal range is between 58 to 62, but sometimes on the highest time frames, as in weekly and monthly, it can often go to 57 and in discretionary rare cases as low as 55 to 56. But that's a stretch that should only be applied on the weekly or monthly. And the same goes for the lower time frames, such as the 1 hour chart, where a higher placement like 63 can be justified. On a quick note though, I don't recommend you to use these RSI strategies for any time frames less than the 1 hour chart, as in the one where each bar represents 1 hour. Moving on to the red RSI lines. The lower one is typically set at around 40, but a normal range is between 39 and 42. Anything outside of that should require a close look to ensure you've not made an error. And finally, the upper bullish is certainly the one with the most wriggle room, and the one that changes the most depending on the time frame. Typically, it should be set at 70 and never ever lower than 68, which on its own is a stretch. On the upside, on the other hand, it can go as high as 80, but not more. Before delving into the magic wonderland of RSI lines, do note that touches don't need to be exact. A ground rule is that a clear touch is a clear touch if it seems to be so with the naked eye on a zoomed out RSI scale. Typically, there is a wriggle room of less than 1%. This means that if a bearish blue line is set at 60, then it still constitutes a clear touch if it stays within 59.5 and 60.5. Of course, the closer to the line, the better, but please refrain from bending the lines. If the RSI is too far off the line, it either means you've set your lines incorrectly, or more likely, it's just not a signal at all. Don't force it. Instead, you are better advised to meticulously calibrate any RSI lines to their optimal pivotal levels. The more accurately you set the lines, the clearer signals they will generate in turn. And the better you get at eventually setting these lines, the more you will find yourself calibrating them on a fractional level. You will realize that 60.2 more properly resembles the correct value as opposed to perhaps 60 sharp, or that 39.85 is the more correct pivotal representation than 40. Do your groundwork properly or don't use these RSI strategies at all. Let's have some looks at my own RSI charts to further clarify and demonstrate the pivotal price levels upon which these lines are determined. Let's use the weekly Swedbank chart, as it more than well proves my point. I personally always start with the upper bearish blue line, as this is the most important one of them all. In this case, we see that the upper bearish blue is kept at our default value of 60. What we mainly look for when setting the upper bearish blue line is for a quick RSI decline from continuously higher RSI levels and to a level where it has a hard time exceeding the upper bearish blue line prospect area. The prime area of relevance when setting the upper bearish blue is the distribution phases. An example of this is March 98. Until that point, the RSI had been in very high RSI territories, often peaking and remaining above the upper red RSI line. After that, in July the same year, the RSI did not manage to break above the prospect upper bearish blue line placement. I say prospect because we yet haven't settled on its exact placement. So far, the level we have found is still a hypothesis that needs to be confirmed. Now, the same happened in January earlier that year after a long divergence. The difference was that it then broke above the upper bearish blue and prices went parabolic. This is a great example of how naked RSI divergences can trick you. But with the RSI breaking above the upper bearish blue line, you can quickly get out of your short position at a minimal loss. All it takes is for the RSI to close above the upper bearish blue line during a distribution phase. Simple as that. In May 2000, the RSI again hit this prospect upper bearish blue level when the price was trading at a local closing high of 110 kroner. It quickly reversed down to 103.80 at lowest, and if we would have taken such trade, we would already have reached at least one sell off target and lowered our stop loss either to break even or to whenever the RSI were to exceed the upper bearish blue. Such decision is of course discretionary and based on your risk profile. Again in May 2002, we had a local price high which coincided with the prospect upper bearish blue. Had you taken this trade at its closing price of 107.90, you could have enjoyed as much as a 32% profit multiplied by whatever leverage you'd have. Now that we have set and confirmed the upper bearish blue line, let us see how well it would have performed in the next crisis, the 2007 one. The RSI behavior during the markup and steep decline until mid-2006 clearly indicates that the price has a longer way up to go, as there were no clear touches of the upper bearish blue and as the RSI closed above it too. After the parabolic run, however, Swedbank quickly entered a textbook distribution phase upon which the RSI went from very high levels and down, just to be rejected exactly on the upper bearish blue, after which the entire stock rolled over and died. A proper trade in this case would be to take a leveraged short position at the closing price of 222.50 kroner when the RSI closed at a perfectly clear touch of the upper bearish blue. The stop loss would be immediately triggered if the RSI were to close above this upper bearish blue, which again means that the risk is absolutely minimal. After this, the price went as low as 14.70 for a 93.4% decline. Of course, you would have sold off a good portion of that trade on its way down, but it would regardless land you at a majestic profit nonetheless, one also multiplied by your leverage. Let's then see how Swedbank is looking today. The price has hovered around in a seemingly 6-year long distribution phase, and all the while there were no clear touches on this confirmed upper bearish blue. Truly mouth-watering risk-to-reward spots, which in turn allow you to utilize greater leverage at a lower risk. But more on that later. Let's now rather open the goodie bag and see what's in it. Then we have the July to September rally, where the RSI made a strong move to the upper bullish red. But as prices contracted at the end of the distribution phase, the RSI again dipped down and made a clear touch on the upper bearish blue RSI line as the price closed at 214.40. And the rest is history. What is extra impressive, however, is that the steep sell-off in February 2019 constituted a confirmed distribution sell-off candle, one that signified the beginning of the markdown phase. But we didn't have to wait for that. The RSI let us in on the trade 5 bars ahead, or 5 weeks earlier in this case. Amazing? Fucking hell yes! And all this stems from a single stupid line. And bear in mind that this line was based on price and RSI pivots dating back more than 20 years. And a line that generated crystal clear signals prior to the 2000 and 2007 crash respectively. And one that generated just as crystal clear signals for the recent markdown from last year. But that's not all. There is more. Moving on to the lower bearish blue line. This line is simpler, much simpler. You mainly look for the strongest continuous RSI support levels, which in this case clearly is the default level of 30. Just look at all these touches. And as mentioned above, the lower bearish blue line is the most static of them all and should rarely be altered from its default value of 30. This brings us to the upper bullish red. Again, we look for pivotal price peaks and where the RSI most frequently reverses. Just like with the lower bearish blue, this one is an easy one. In Swedbank's case on the weekly chart, it goes at 69. The prime function of the upper bearish red and the lower bearish blue are to confirm bullish or bearish RSI channels. For once the price touches or breaks either of these lines, a new RSI channel is automatically confirmed. But more on that later. This leaves us with the lower bullish red. As mentioned earlier, this line should be set as close to 40 as possible, but within an acceptable range of 39 to 42. In this case in Swedbank, we have again left it at its default of 40, as it clearly shows to be a frequently recurring pivot level. The lower bullish red line is an important one, as it is similar in function to the upper bearish blue. Just like the upper bearish blue line warns us of a soon-to-come markdown, the lower bullish red indicates that a markup is coming. Let me again prove my point here. From the peak prior to the 2000 IT crash and all the way through its markdown and relatively short accumulation phase, the price bottomed out in late September 2002. Just like distribution phases have gradual RSI declines, so do accumulation phases, but in reverse. In this case, we saw a bullish RSI divergence followed by a steady RSI recovery. And just like the RSI gradually declines and makes clear retest touches that don't surpass the upper bearish blue prior to severe markdowns, the same is valid in reverse for accumulation phases. In this case, the RSI gradually found its way up, after which it neatly bounced on the lower bullish red, which on its own also constituted a minor support level. This is where you go long, and again your stop loss is immediately triggered if the RSI closes below the lower bullish red. In this case, the closing price was 80.20 kroner, and one that eventually peaked at 235.70 for an almost 200% profit multiplied by your leverage. And given how tight your stop losses are due to this technique, you can apply it while leverage without risking much. In this case, you could easily have gone for 10x, which at most would have generated a 2000% profit, or 20 times your investment. The attentive viewer may wonder why I ignored the previous test of the lower bullish red. The reason for this is because the RSI movement towards the retest needs to be more distinguishable. This one is so tiny you can barely see it. We want a motion with a clear direction, like the May 2002 distributional RSI move towards the upper bearish blue, or in this case the clear and sweeping RSI move that led to the sharp January 2003 retest. But perhaps you think this was all a fluke.
You're talking absolute shit again.
Wow, we'll see.
That is no way that happened.
That was simply a lucky guess, and that the RSI and price just happened to both simultaneously bounce on that very pivotal level, which in turn happened to coincide with the lower bullish red line. Well, it's not a coincidence. Let's look at the next crisis then, shall we? The 2007 housing and banking crash. First of all, V-shaped market bottom recoveries are rare. This is rarely how market cycles end, unless they're tampered with. This bottom is rather the result of fiscal stimulus and of governments and central banks targeting certain sectors with financial support. But here's the beauty, we still get a technical entry point. After the steep 2011 correction, the RSI reached and surpassed the lower bearish blue, upon which it quickly reversed alongside the RSI. The RSI made a clear test of the lower bullish red together with the price at its local low. Again, the price shot upwards and the lower bullish red touch was again an early clue of a markup phase to come. Following this clue, we would be able to buy in at the closing price of 79 kroner and with a hefty leverage at that. Traditional traders, on the other hand, would wait until mid-October 2012 as the price retested a previous local top, which also constituted a support and resistance level. Such entry would then take place at 117 kroner, and any such long would need to come with a wide stop loss as prices could still fluctuate wildly. Prices eventually peaked at 234 kroner for a maximum potential profit of again another 200% multiplied by your leverage. Bear in mind that the proper placement of the RSI lines are incredibly critical. Screw them up just a tiny bit and all you're left with is noise. Put them right on the other hand and you're likely in for the treat of your life. In the next episode, you will be spoiled with examples, for they sure aren't difficult to find. Now, the function of the naked green RSI line has to do with market phase shifts. During a distribution phase, prior to the retest of the upper bearish blue line, the RSI needs to touch or dip below the green RSI line, or at least be close enough. The same applies too in reverse for accumulation to markup phases. Now, this was a thorough study and examination of the naked RSI lines. Go get yourself some coffee and a cinnamon bun, for you deserve it. And if you don't deserve it, go do some push-ups and count to 1,000.
1, 2, 3, 4,
and whenever you're done, we're ready to move on to the next part, RSI channels. Now, whatever value the RSI is at any given moment, it is either trading within the confirmed bullish red channel or within the bearish blue channel. This on its own shows the equity's fundamental technical strength in relation to its time frame. First of all, the longer such channel is, whether bearish or bullish, the stronger and more prevailing it is. A prime example of this is the OMXS30 and how it for 9 straight years remained in the bullish red RSI channel on the weekly chart. This abruptly ended in March 2020. For all it takes for a channel to shift from bullish to bearish or the other way around is for it to touch or break through the upper bearish red or the lower bearish blue line, by however little. The Swedish OMXS 30 index is therefore now trading in a confirmed bearish blue channel. If the RSI is trading within a bullish red channel and the RSI reaches 30.2 or 30.02 for that matter when the lower bearish blue is set at 30, it does not qualify for a channel shift and hence the channel remains bullish. Do not forget that. There's a reason for this. Of course, as mentioned earlier, all this is only relevant on the higher time frames. We're talking the daily, weekly, and monthly primarily. Long sustainable bullish channels are a sign of health, just as well as long and sustainable bearish channels are a sign of weakness. Steep RSI movements, on the other hand, where the channel ranges from bullish to bearish to bullish again, is another story. This is a sign of sideways movements, formation creations, or of accumulation and distribution phases in the making. But more on that later. With regards to long and smooth RSI channels, such as the year and a half long bullish channel in Fingerprint, they eventually all come to an end. Twice the RSI retraced significantly, once in mid-January 2016 and the other time about 2-3 weeks later. But as close as they may have been to the lower bearish blue line, they never touched nor crossed it. And hence the channel remained bullish. But that doesn't mean we weren't given some very important clues. Once a markup is done and the equity enters the distribution phase, you will begin to see how the RSI gradually hovers downwards. Technically, you could say that you begin to see gradually lower highs and lower lows. In this sense, we are not talking about lower individual RSI highs and lows, but rather the fact that the new highs and lows are generally lower than those preceding them, and typically and conveniently in the region of the upper bearish blue line. During the 2015 markup, for example, the RSI often traded above the upper bullish red, which in itself is a significant sign of strength. Throughout its 2016 distribution phase, however, it struggled to even find its way up to the upper bullish red at all. And at the end of the distribution in late 2016, it would barely make it to the green RSI line. But the important thing to notice is how the RSI channel entered the distribution phase in a bullish red channel on the daily, and how it roughly halfway through swapped and entered the bearish blue RSI channel. All this was finalized by a clean upper bearish blue line touch upon which Fingerprint cards came crashing down. And all the while, the unknowing trader would still think the stock was stuck in a non-directional distribution phase. Now, different RSI channels come with different levels of price strengths. The narrower and more extremely located those RSI channels are, the more drastic the price movements. A normal RSI channel in a normal equity under normal circumstances, whether bullish or bearish, typically utilizes the majority of the RSI field. A bearish channel might, for example, hover wildly between 27 and 67. This would constitute a gradual price decline, but not one to be necessarily worried about, and typically occurs when the price is not in a clear markup or markdown phase, but rather a bit directionless. Such equity behavior is more frequently occurring than one may think, and in such cases we must always keep an eye on reversal signals as they can occur with short notice. The narrower and more extremely located an RSI channel is, the stronger or weaker it is. Continuous moves above the upper bullish red or below the lower bearish blue are again prime examples of this, but they rarely last for too long before getting exhausted. Then we have what I call a bullish or bearish RSI motorway. A bullish RSI motorway is when the RSI persistently moves above the upper bearish blue. This can go on for long stretches of time, like in Fingerprint between November 2012 until early February 2013, which on its own constituted a 480% price increase. The same applies in reverse too for a bearish RSI motorway. This is when the RSI continuously trades below the lower bullish red. Whenever an equity is on a steady RSI motorway course, prices tend to move steadily, either rising steeply or declining at an alarming pace. So what about the green RSI line when we talk about RSI channels? When the price is trending downwards, for example, and the RSI barely makes it to the green RSI line, it is a sign of significant weakness, one that shows no sign of reversing. A textbook example of this is Fingerprint Cars' frequent rejection of the green RSI line from September 2016, when the price was still trading within the distribution phase, and all the way to June 2017, when it finally managed to at least push through. During this time alone, Fingerprint lost 70% of its company value. This RSI push through was quickly rejected, upon which a new try was initiated whilst hovering in a sideways range. The RSI again got rejected for another full ride of a markdown. It will last all the way to the summer of 2018 before the RSI managed to break above this toxically low level, which incidentally also happened to coincide with the very midst of the accumulation phase. If you, in the case of Fingerprint Cars, were to sell or short on the second green RSI rejection at 85 kroner, right when the price closed below the green RSI line, and you were to buy it back or close your short once it had closed and stayed above it for at least 2 days to ensure it wasn't just another V-shaped rejection, you would have closed the position at 33.50 for a solid 60% decline. If you were to then be attentive enough, you would notice that the RSI aggressively made its way from below the bearish blue line and all the way above the bullish red in the matter of 2 months, or over the course of 42 bars, which is of course much too fast for a healthy trading development. You would, given the nature of the RSI clues, know that the price was stuck in either a sideways movement or in a formation creation. A bear flag, such in this case, for example. But here is where the discretionary skills of technical analysis become truly beautiful. For if we go back to the markup phase, we see that this very 41 krona level was in itself a strong level of support between July and September 2015, upon which a sale or short would be a superb swing play. And all clues supplied to us by deep level RSI usage. This bear flag was nothing short of a power amassing move in order to have enough energy to push down further. And from August 2017 and all the way to June 2018, the RSI continued its smooth ride in this extremely bearish territory, one that is much weaker than if the price were to regularly touch and test the upper bearish blue. In this case, we are talking about another markdown from 36 kroner and down to 7.24 for an additional 80% loss of stock value. This was the initiation to the wild RSI swings, which was accompanied by a clear accumulation phase. For a full technical analysis on Fingerprint Cards, please find it linked to at the end of this episode. For Fingerprint Cards, certainly has a good way up to go once the stock exits its accumulation phase. That is, unless the global markets come crashing down before that. So what then would indicate that Fingerprint Cards were about to enter a markup phase? Just as we had extreme RSI movements in the distribution phase, where the RSI went from the bullish red channel to entering the bearish blue on the daily, the same needs to happen in the accumulation phase. The RSI needs to enter a bullish channel and stay there. Just as the RSI struggled to break above the green RSI already back in the distribution channel, it would be equally bullish if the RSI, confirmed in a bullish red channel of course, were to struggle to break below the green RSI and all the while testing and taking out the top of the accumulation range. In this case, the RSI would initially need to break the upper bullish red line and then stay there for some time while the price continues to hover. Eventually, and as the price has hovered long enough to be ready, and ideally when the RSI has struggled to break below the green RSI, once the price were to break above the upper accumulation range of 21 to 22 kroner, that's when you can expect some fast and persistent moves to the north. And that's when I will go in heavily myself. Do bear in mind that we are not there yet though. In terms of bullish and bearish RSI channels, the biggest long-term sign of strength or weakness is when the RSI has a hard time finding its way past the green RSI line. Trends like these can go on and on, and if you ever spot an equity whose RSI moves below the green RSI line for the most of the time, you can be certain you have found yourself a proper loser. One that you should shy like the plague, at least until they've proven elsewhere. That is, of course, unless you are looking for proper shorting opportunities. This brings us to the final RSI channel behavior, the sideways movement. Now, a fast RSI move across the field is vastly different from a slow one. For when the RSI swings wildly between the lower bearish blue and the upper bearish red line, and actually touching or crossing them, it is typically a sure sign of sideways movements. A fast one means either sideways movements ahead or a formation creation in the making. In such case, you may expect wild swings within a certain range, whether static, as in between roughly the same bottoms and tops, or putting it differently, a sideways range, or locally trending, as in bull and bear flags and pennants. When the RSI moves from one extreme to the other, but over the course of more chart bars, as in practically over more time, it is a sign of a trend change. We have seen this before. Fingerprint cards is an ideal example and one which I keep returning to. For more on this, please watch the episode Record Week Market and Grand Shorting Opportunity Ahead. As we have thoroughly discussed, when the distribution phase is ready to turn into a markdown, it very often gives us an early warning. The RSI goes from a high territory to immediately gear down and touch the upper bearish blue line before prices find their way down. These signals or clues are often followed by a steadily declining RSI, which typically halfway through the markdown confirm a bearish channel. We see this very behavior on the OMXS30, both for the 2000 IT and 2007 housing crash respectively. The key to all this is the gearing down, which is mostly a signal in distribution phases. This is manifested by its smooth sweeping motions, where the RSI slowly but steadily finds its way down from distribution phases to markdowns, and from upwards from accumulation phases to markups. This on its own shows why the big dip in May 2010 was an obvious correction with predicted sideways movements to come, because the RSI went down from above the bullish red and all the way down below the bearish blue in one steep and aggressive fashion. And what did we get? Exactly, sideways movements. In this case, an ascending triangle, which then proceeded upwards, but just by a tiny bit. What is extraordinarily interesting is just that the price didn't continue much higher, and all the while the RSI remained in the bearish blue channel. This is important and a prime example of how the RSI can be properly used as a leading indicator. Have a look at the chart again. The price continued to hover sideways on a higher plateau for some time, and all the while the RSI never once touched or broke above the bullish red. The OMXS30 eventually went on to drop 24.5% in just 1 month. I'm aware this might have been a lot to take in, but if you are serious about your trading, I strongly recommend that you do what you can to fully grasp this, as this is a tool that greatly dwarfs everything else. And the most important thing to take with you from this episode is the typical RSI behaviors as an equity goes from a distribution phase to a markdown, and from an accumulation phase to a markup. Perfecting this on its own can be worth its weight in diamonds. In the next episode, we will go through plenty of practical examples of how these techniques have panned out as crystal clear cut signals in different equities and how you could have profited royally from them. We will also go through examples of when they did not work out. Until then, happy trading.